particularly hard to maintain human rights at the top of the agenda. I think that we're very fortunate that as we are featuring such a unique book addressing the fate of North Korean refugees and North Korean human rights, two of our discussants are held back at a hearing on the Hill addressing North Korean human rights, and I hope that the human rights community here continues to stay as busy as it is today. I am now going to turn the floor over to our next speaker, Mr. Kim Song-min, who comes from a military background, and I know that he's always ready to execute right away. So he's a former captain, actually, in the North Korean Army. He's a winner of the Reporters Without Borders Media Award and the Asia Democracy and Human Rights Award. And he's also well known for being the founder and director of Free North Korea Radio. He escaped from North Korea, was arrested in China, and then subsequently repatriated. Because he had served as a captain in the North Korean military, he was subjected to execution. He faced imminent death. He narrowly escaped by jumping from a moving train. And after eventually escaping to South Korea, he has become one of the most active leaders of among North Korean defectors, having served as the chairman of the North Korean Defectors Association and also as chair of the annual North Korea Freedom Week since the event was moved to Seoul in 2010. Mr. Henry Song will be Mr. Kim Song-min's interpreter, although I suspect that his English is great. He's still reluctant to speak English. I hope that will happen at future events. Mr. Kim, the floor is yours.
Thank you. 처음 뵈는 분보다 아는 분이 더 많은 것 같아서요. 저기 전 박수 사장님부터 시작해서 정말 난리군 얼굴을 이렇게 뵙게 돼서 정말 고맙습니다.
Hello, welcome everyone. And it seems like there are more faces that I recognize here than new faces here. So thank you.
밀란 선생이 책 썼다는 소리 서울에서 듣고요. 진짜 보고 싶어 죽겠는데 그 내 영어를 몰라서 못 보고 있습니다. 후에 꼭 보겠습니다.
And I also want to point out that Mr. Fox, longtime friend, is here also. And when I was in Korea, I heard that Miss Melanie Kirkpatrick wrote this book, and I want to read this so badly, but my English, my poor English skills will not allow me to read this book right away.
Hopefully we'll have a Korean version one day.
예, 감사합니다. 저보다 제가 좀 늦었지만 구제희 박사님이 그 탈북자들의 삶에 대해서 말씀하시는 거 제가 들었고요. 평소부터 구 박사님은 탈북자들에 대해서는 너무 잘 알고 있는 분이기 때문에 제가 특별히 할 이야기가 있을까 지금 고민스럽습니다.
And I arrived a bit late, and I did hear Dr. Koo talk a little bit about the North Korean refugees and defectors. And he is someone who cares very deeply about the North Korean refugees and defectors and very well aware of the situation regarding them. And I'm a bit concerned that since he spoke, I really don't know what I should talk about here.
그 우리 밀라니 선생이 탈북자의 삶을 그린 책을 썼다고 그래서 정말 궁금합니다. 솔직히 어떤 내용이 담겼을까가 먼저 궁금한데 일단 후에 한국판이 나온다니까 그때 꼭 보기로 하고 제가 그 아주 오래전에 우리 밀라니 선생한테 들려줬던 탈북자의 시 한 편 짧은 거 한번 읊어드릴까 합니다.
And regarding Ms. Kirkpatrick's book, since it is about the North Korean refugees, truthfully speaking, I really wonder what it's about, the contents of the book. So I will make sure to read it when it does come out in the Korean language. And I would like to recite a poem that I recited to Ms. Kirkpatrick a long time ago, right now.
제목은 고백이고요.
And the title is Confession.
떠나던 나를 위해 아무도 울어준 이 없는 것이 고향입니다.
My hometown is a place where when I left, nobody wept for me.
하지만 그곳은 내가 나서 첫 걸음 익힌 곳, 못다한 나의 사랑일 수 있습니다.
However, that place where I took my first steps perhaps is the place where my love is.
끝입니다.
Oh, that's it.
우리 탈북자들이 고향을 떠날 때 정말 고향만 떠나는 게 아니라 지금껏 살아온 자신들의 모든 것을 놓고 오고 있습니다.
And when North Koreans leave North Korea, they do not only leave their hometown or where they were born, but they're leaving behind everything.
사랑하는 사람들, 내가 배웠던 모든 것, 그리고 내가 누렸던 삶 전체를 놓고 오는 슬픔을 겪는 것이 탈북자들입니다.
It's a life where it's a situation where the North Koreans leave their loved ones, everything that they know and learned about, and it's a very sad situation when they leave North Korea.
그런 아픔에 비해서 어떻게 보면 몽골로 그 박사님 아까 말씀하셨지만 몽골로 베트남으로 캄보디아로 혹은 중국에서 그 탈북자의 삶 이런 것들은 어떻게 보면 그 고향을 떠날 때 아픔보다 덜 아픈 걸 수도 있죠.
And I could almost say that compared to the pain of actually leaving North Korea, the experience of actually going to Mongolia or, as Dr. Koo mentioned, other countries such as Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, I think leaving Korea itself is far more painful and more miserable than going to these countries.
제 이야기도 말씀 앞에서 나왔기 때문에 그냥 짧게 말씀드리면 중국에서의 3년 동안 탈북자 생활 그리고 밀선을 타려고 했다가 다시 북한으로 적세를 차고 끌려가던 그 뭐 아픔 그리고 다시 또 이제 중국 대륙을 횡단하던 뭐 그런 육체적인 그리고 환경 이런 것보다도 지금도 저한테 아픈 것은 내가 떠나던 고향 고향과 그 헤어지던 그 순간 그게 지금도 아픔으로 남아 있습니다.
Regarding my life, I know it was briefly talked about before we came, but I lived for 3 years in China as a refugee. And my attempt to flee China for freedom on a ship was foiled, and I was arrested and led away in handcuffs. And more so than the physical aspect of leaving, for me right now, even to this day, it's the emotional and the pain that I feel in my heart that I experience when I remember the separation, that feeling of separation that I went through.
좀 슬픈 이야기지만 여기 우리 탈북자가 2만 4천 명이라고 하고 있는데 그보다 훨씬 더 많은 수가 자유를 찾지 못하고 중국에서 혹은 몽골리아에서 죽지 않았나 그런 아픈 마음도 늘 가지고 있습니다.
And I also have a sad heart regarding the North Korean refugees. More than the number 24,000 who have resettled in South Korea, a bigger number than that have died trying to reach freedom, whether that's in China or in Mongolia.
어떤 영화의 줄거리가 된 이야기인데요. 탈북자 9명이 몽골의 그 사막을 8일 동안 오다가 모두 지쳐가지고 11살짜리 어린애가 따라서지 못하는 걸 알면서도 저들도 죽을 수 있기 때문에 계속 끝까지 왔다는 이야기가 있습니다. 그리고 그 아이는 혼자 몽골 사막에서 죽었고 그 아이의 아빠는 그 아이의 시체라도 찾아오겠다고 몽골 대통령에게 19번 편지를 써서 4년 후에 국경으로 가서 A 죽음을 아들의 죽음을 가져왔던 그런 이야기가 있습니다.
And there's a certain motion picture film. The plot is based on a real life story that happened whereby 9 North Korean defectors, they were wandering the Mongolian desert searching for a way out to freedom. And among the 9 was an 11-year-old boy. And this boy ended up dying in the desert. And the father of the 11-year-old boy that died pleaded with the Mongolian president, wrote him 19 letters to at least bring back the body of his son from the desert. And that was finally realized after many attempts to do so.
북한을 떠나서 중국 대륙을 횡단해서 몽골과는 조금 다른 방향, 이를테면 베트남으로 가는 방향, 탈북 루트가 또 하나 있죠. 그 탈북...
And there is another route when North Koreans leave North Korea besides going through China and then onto Mongolia, and that route is going to Vietnam.
쿤밍이라는 중국의 끝점, 그리고 거기서 지나가면 베트남이 되고 그 긴 베트남을 또다시 횡단하면 캄보디아가 됩니다. 그 베트남과 캄보디아를 가르는 약 10m 폭 10m밖에 안 되는 그 물길이 쫙 되어 있습니다. 서해 국경을 표하는.
And from the southernmost city in China, Kunming, to it's which is right near Vietnam, and then going through the slender country, the geographical graphically slender country of Vietnam, which leads to Cambodia. Between the Cambodian and Vietnam border, there is a riverway or waterway that is a very short distance of only 10 meters that separates the two countries.
북한에서 그 베트남까지 거리가 약 4,000km가 되는데요. 탈북자들은 그 4,000km까지 뒤 한 번 돌아보지 못하고 계속 갑니다. 삶을 찾아서. 거기서 10m의 국경을 지나면 서히 마음을 넣을 수 있는 캄보디아가 눈앞에 있습니다.
North Koreans, when they leave North Korea, the refugees, when they travel to Vietnam, the total distance is about 4,000 kilometers. And once they start on this journey, they cannot look back because they are searching, going on this journey for better life. And only when they cross that 10-meter wide river between Cambodia and Vietnam, once they are in Cambodia, can they rest at ease and actually feel safe.
9일을 9명의 탈북자가 갔던 적이 있어요. 우리 자유북한 방송국에 나는 중국에서 사는 누군데 도와달라. 그래서 우리 방송국에서 그렇게 워낙 방송이 어렵기 때문에 탈북자까지 도와주는 것 정말 참 어려운 일이지만 우리 자유북한 방송국 원칙은 전화 걸려온 사람은 무조건 데려온다라는 원칙이 있었기 때문에 약 500명 정도의 탈북자들이 우리의 소개를 받고 왔는데 그 중에 9명 정도가 이제 떠났던 적이 있어요. 바로 그 4,000km를.
And that 4,000 km route from North Korea through to Vietnam. At one point, there were 9 North Korean refugees that traveled this route. And one of the defectors, that refugees that was part of this group, actually called our radio station, Free North Korea Radio, asking for help, telling us that, listen, we are refugees in China. We want to go on this route, so please help us. And at that time, our radio station was in a very difficult situation. But it, I considered our principle that we will help whoever calls our station. So far we've had about 500 people, 500 North Korean refugees contact our station requesting for help.
그 가운데 그 9명 중에 LA의 그 대표적인 한인교회인 베델 한인교회의 선인식이라는 목사님이 저에게 이제 부탁했던 21살짜리 여자아이가 있었어요. 얘가 중국에서 어떻게 연락이 와서 나한테까지 연락이 왔는데 당신 내가 좀 도와줄 수 없냐 그래서 얼마든지 해서 암명제에 끼어서 지금 도착했던 순간.
And among the nine, there was a young 21-year-old North Korean defector woman who sought help from a well-known Korean-American megachurch pastor in LA, Pastor Peter Son of Irvine Bethel Church. And it was requested that we help this woman as well.
근데 그 도착했던 날이 마침 그 전날에 비가 와가지고 10m 폭, 높이는 거의 2m밖에 안 되는 그 수로에 물이 조금 더 불었답니다. 비가 와가지고. 그래서 안내하는 사람이 이거 오늘은 못 건너가겠다. 돌아서자고 했는데 이 친구가 돌아를 못 서고 전화가 왔어요. 무조건 오늘 건너가야 되겠다. 눈앞에 자유가 있는데 왜 말리느냐. 그래서 거기 안내하던 친구가 그럼 건너가자 하고 9명을 다 수용할 줄 아냐 수용할 줄 안다고 했는데 다 건너가 보니까 그 친구 하나만 없더랍니다.
And the day when they arrived, the group arrived at the riverbank to cross the 10-meter wide river between Cambodia and Vietnam. It was raining a lot at that time, so it was a little bit deeper than usual. And the guide said, we cannot cross, we must turn back. But that young woman said, no, the freedom is right before our eyes, we must cross the river. So the guide asked them, do all of you know how to swim? And they replied, yes. But when they crossed the river, they found out that that woman was the only one who didn't make it across.
그렇게 죽어간, 이름 없이 죽어간, 그 2m밖에 안 되는 물에 빠져 죽어간, 그리고 사막에서 죽어간, 그리고 우리가 알지 못하게 죽어간 탈북자들이 얼마일까 그런 생각을 늘 하면서 오늘을 우리들은 행복을 살고 있습니다.
And that nameless young woman who perished in only 2 meter deep water, and other defectors who perished in the desert and who perished in other ways, we wonder how many more out there died these silent, nameless deaths, and we wonder about that. well, we are here living in comfort and safety.
그렇게 우리가 그 표현을 못하는 말로 다 표현 못하는 그런 탈북 스토리, 탈북 내용들이 정말 얼마나 많은지요. 생각하고 생각하고 하다가 우리 탈북자들이 십시일반으로 돈을 모아서 이름하여 탈북 스토리를 담은 북한과 중국 그 48 최단 거리 48m에서 벌어지는 탈북 스토리를 담은 영화 48m라는 것을 만들었습니다. 그리고 여기에 워싱턴에 가지고 왔습니다.
And we thought about these North Koreans who died these miserable deaths, and we thought about how many more out there like this suffer like this, and we thought about it. We came together and we decided that we will pull our own money, our own resources, and we will make a movie that highlights the stories, the real life stories of these defectors, what they go through when they leave North Korea. And we specifically pinpointed the region between North Korea and China in the Yalu River. The distance is only 48 meters. And we titled this movie 48M, 48 meters. And this is the film that we brought to Washington, D.C.
꼭 관심 가지시고 그 봐주시길 부탁드리겠고요. 그리고 제가 그 보스로서 우리 밀라니 선생한테 부탁드리고 싶은데 그 좋은 필력으로 우리 영화 한번 소개해 주시죠.
And please show great interest in that film and view the screening which will be held tonight. And I would just like to end my statement by asking Ms. Kirkpatrick, please use the power of your mighty pen and let's promote our film. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Kim Song-min, thank you for your courage and your relentless efforts. Our next discussant is a true force of nature. She has been the driving force behind the North Korean human rights movement for so many years. Suzanne Schulte, president of the Defense Forum Foundation, a nonprofit educational foundation tasked to sponsor programs on Capitol Hill addressing foreign policy, defense, and human rights. She's also co-vice chair of our own committee on human rights in North Korea. 15 years ago, she was the first one to bring here to Washington, D.C., two well-known North Korean defectors who were given an opportunity to speak, Colonel Tae-joo-hwal and a former senior diplomat, Mr. Ko Yong-hwan, who also happens to be here today in the audience. We're very glad he has been able to join us. And so many other well-known names. Kang Tol-hwan, author of The Aquariums of Pyongyang, a book that brought so much attention to North Korean human rights. Over 38 North Korean defectors have visited the United States, often on multiple occasions, and all owing to Suzanne Schulte's relentless efforts. Without further ado, Suzanne, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I do apologize profusely that Kim Song-min and I were late, but part of the reason why we were late, because the question came up in the congressional hearing, is why aren't people paying attention to the North Korea? You know, North Korea is the worst human rights tragedy. Why aren't people paying attention? And I just want to start by thanking Melanie Kirkpatrick. I can say I have been involved in this issue since 1996. Few journalists have done what she has done in trying to get these issues out and written about this issue consistently. Now more and more people are paying attention, but it was really Melanie that was using the power of the pen to write about these issues. So we're deeply grateful to her for that from the activist community. I think on behalf of the North Korean defectors, I say, we approve this message. But I want to make a couple of quick points, because I know we need to have time for questions. But first of all, regarding China and then regarding U.S. policy. Regarding China, the government of China is directly responsible for the horrific conditions that are happening to these refugees by not recognizing them as refugees and calling them economic migrants, which it continues to do, even though the moment they cross the border, and I'm sure you mentioned this during the discussion, even though the moment they cross the border, they fit the definition of refugees, because if they're sent back, they will most certainly be tortured, most certainly be imprisoned, in some cases executed for the crime of leaving their homeland. China knows this, and they cannot hide behind this claim, because we have the evidence that when they do arrest these refugees, that they're literally marking them for death, because when they interview the refugees and they're finding out they're trying to go to South Korea, or whether they were just trying to work in China to get money for their families, they're marking the papers, the interrogation papers, and handing this over to the North Koreans so the North Koreans know which ones were trying to come to South Korea, which means they're marking them for death, because when they repatriate and they know they'll be executed. But in addition, the environment in China by having this repatriation policy has created this lawless environment where you have over 80% of North Korean women being trafficked. There are markets where North Korean women are being bought and sold. And this is what Laura Ling and Anna Lee were trying to expose. That was why they were in China. They were trying to get the story out. And you all know what happened to them. They ended up in Pyongyang, and Bill Clinton had to rescue them. But that's why they went to China. They wanted to expose the trafficking of North Korean women. This is an embarrassment to China. It's why they work so hard to prevent people from exposing what they're doing to these refugees. It's a situation where you have children that not only have no access to medical care or health care, these are orphans that are in China, but they can't even go outside to play for fear that they may be arrested and sent back to North Korea. So it's a horrific problem. In addition to that, you've had Americans, Japanese, Chinese, South Koreans in prison, as Melanie's pointed out in her book and a story particularly about Steve Kim, had them been in prison in China because they were helping refugees. And most recently, the South Korean citizen Kim Yong-hwan was imprisoned and tortured because he was caught trying to help refugees, while last year, a South Korean missionary named Kim Chang-won was murdered by North Korean agents, and another, Kang Ho-bin, survived an assassination attempt, but was killed in May of this year in a very suspicious car crash. Now, how ironic is it that China, that wants to be seen as a world leader, how ironic is it that they allow North Korean assassins to roam freely in their country, but will not allow the UNHCR access to these refugees? The other problem that I see that we've had is that our country has not been leaders on this issue. The United States has failed to lead on this issue. We've only seen a handful, 150 refugees, nothing, that have been able to make it to the United States. We have been reactive, not proactive. We only react when refugees try to seek asylum, but we do nothing to try to help them. And despite the U.S. Congress, which has three times passed a North Korea Human Rights Act, showing clearly their intent for the U.S. to do more to help refugees, there's only been a small number that have been able to make it here. I also believe, and I think that Melanie is absolutely right in some of the comments she makes about China in this book. I do absolutely believe that there is a case to be made that we can convince China that it is in their best interest to change their policy. It is in China's best interest for reform to come to North Korea, but they are creating a situation by really letting the regime off the hook by forcing the refugees back, which relieves any pressure on this regime to establish any kind of reforms because they force these refugees back. I also believe that the problem we have is that we have to remember that the Communist Party is in charge of China, and they want to continue to coddle this dictatorship, whereas the reformers in China know that if reform comes to North Korea, and it's inevitable that this regime is going to collapse, the defectors are predicting now it's going to be within the next 3 years, that it's actually in China's best interest to have a unified Korea that could be an economic partner with China, and it would actually benefit China economically. But of course, the communist dictatorship doesn't want to have that partnership because they fear that. But the reformers in China know that that would actually be in China's best interest rather than constantly trying to bail out North Korea and continue to coddle this dictator. The other point I want to make, too, is that we hear this repeatedly, and Kim Sung-min eloquently dramatized this in his poem. North Koreans don't want to leave North Korea. They leave North Korea because they feel they have no choice. And if you talk to the defectors in South Korea, they all want to go back to their homeland and build it into a democracy that has human rights like they've seen and lived under in South Korea. So finally, I just want to say another point is that this is a unique refugee situation. It could be solved overnight because North Korean refugees are the only refugees in the world that have an immediate place for resettlement. They're unique in that they have that. They're citizens of South Korea under the South Korean Constitution. And I just want to conclude by one point that I want to make is that we have plenty of Harriet Tubmans, as Melanie Kirkpatrick has pointed out in her book. We have plenty of people that are willing to risk their lives to help these refugees, but we have no Raoul Wallenbergs. We haven't found a diplomat yet that's willing to stick their neck out to really get involved in helping these refugees. And yet, we know that our government, our Congress, very much wants us to do more. So with that, I want to just conclude, but I just want to say that, Melanie, thank you so much for the amazing effort that you've done in this pen in the last two, spending the last 2 years doing this book. I just so grateful to you.
Thank you very much, Suzanne. Before we proceed with a brief Q&A, I would also like to say that in addition to Mr. Kim Song-min and Mr. Ko Yong-hwan, there are three other North Korean defectors who have joined us today. We are absolutely delighted that they have attended their program. We welcome their presence and we thank them for their courage and everything they do for a good cause.